Hello, everyone. I'm delighted to welcome you here for this new edition of Strategy, an event that we are all deeply attached to at LFDE. Our new CEO, Bettina Durka, who should have been with us, was unable to attend at the last minute, so I have the honor of doing the introduction today. This 2021 edition is exceptional, first of all because it will be held virtually, and also because we have the pleasure of gathering together for the very first time all our clients, be they individuals, advisors in asset management, banking advisors, or institutionals. We're also receiving for the very first time, and this is a real pleasure, our customers from abroad, from Germany, from Austria, from Belgium and Luxembourg, from Spain and Italy, or even from Switzerland, in a multi-language version. In 2020, LFDE continued to be a special and committed establishment. An establishment that was built to face challenges, implementing a real management of conviction that is independent and powerful. We are stock pickers, we're excited about stock picking, long-term investors, and pioneers, often driven by a taste for innovation that is deeply anchored in our DNA. Our founding expertise in picking small and mid-cap stocks in France and Europe was extended with success to international capitalizations. We plan to accelerate our growth in France and in Europe by cultivating a taste for innovation, enabling us to explore new worlds. I'm thinking in particular of international thematic equity management. Our investment philosophy, still intact, is based on independent research, on meeting with entrepreneurs around the world, and a strong conviction. No value can be created without taking into account environmental, social, and governance criteria. And at LFDE, you know that we grant a special role to analyzing corporate governance. This know-how was shaped 30 years ago. And yes, LFDE will be celebrating its 30th anniversary this year. It is constantly enriched to be able to offer you the best possible performance and the best performance risk ratio possible. All of these assets have enabled performance to be there once again for most of our range, and even particularly remarkable performances for several of our strategies. In this atypical and extreme year of 2020, LFDE saw a wonderful momentum in terms of our management and at commercial level in France and in Europe, without forgetting other territories that we're exploring from Chile to Canada, including Israel, for example. A momentum of inflows was homogeneous and exceptional, the strongest in our history. Accelerating, innovating, serving you would only be possible with the support of the primonial group to which LFDE belongs and given us the means to achieve our ambitions. Our ambitions relate to France with our historical partners and clients, our roots, as well as other countries where we operate. Accelerating our growth, innovating once and again by strengthening our global and thematic equity range, maintaining a high level of performance in terms of our historical European expertise and going further in SRI and impact. These are the main dimensions of this new year opening up for LFDE, a year based on investment strategy that I will be revealing in a few moments with a part of the management team, a year that I wish for all of you to be a gentle and dynamic year by the size of LFDE. But before that, you can take a look at the year 2020.
Today, I'm pleased to announce the United States will join 1 Trillion Trees Initiative.
We're committed to build the society of the future in a way that is socially, economically, but also environmentally sustainable.
La solution, planter 1000 milliards d'arbres sur la planète.
Un nouveau coronavirus fait craindre une épidémie mondiale. Wuhan, épicentre de l'épidémie, est désormais sous quarantaine. 56 millions de personnes sont confinées.
La quarantaine imposée dans le nord du pays concerne depuis lundi soir toute l'Italie pour tenter d'endiguer la propagation du coronavirus.
Tout sera mis en œuvre pour protéger nos salariés et pour protéger nos entreprises. Quoi qu'il en coûte,
La flora e la fauna della laguna di Venezia durante il lockdown non sono cambiate. È cambiata la nostra possibilità di vederla.
Stocks are now down nearly 11%.
Demand is dropping around the world caused by everyone stopping to drive, they're not flying, all from the coronavirus.
Zero. Ignition. Liftoff.
Just amazing. I was just telling Mike, I'm astonished at how big it's going to be.
This is Verkhoyansk, a Siberian town located above the Arctic Circle.
38 degrees Celsius, c'est évidemment un record historique.
The term limit's going to be reset, so the president can run two more times. Vladimir Putin until 2036.
Quand l'Allemagne et la France se mettent ensemble, elles ne peuvent pas tout, mais si elles ne se mettent pas ensemble, rien n'est possible.
4 août 2020, une date qui marquera à jamais l'histoire du Liban.
You ready to go to work?
I'm so ready to go to work.
Cela faisait 493 jours que le royaume attendait la nomination d'un nouveau premier ministre. Voilà chose faite.
Dos mujeres, la francesa Emmanuelle Charpentier y la estadounidense Jennifer Doudna, han sido premiadas con el Nobel de Química 2020.
The government has decided that the evidence of a potentially grave situation arising in the weeks ahead is now too strong.
Ein anderes Thema wird heute zwar überlagert, aber dennoch bewegt es viele. Natürlich geht es um Corona.
Les deux entités affirment que le vaccin, basé sur une technologie nouvelle, est efficace à 90%.
Pour la première fois, une capsule Hyperloop a emporté à son bord deux passagers.
The results tonight have been phenomenal.
And it is now my great honor to introduce the president-elect of the United States of America.
This was a very well-telegraphed move, and Yellen has received praise from all sides as the nominee for Treasury Secretary.
The UK is the first Western country to start vaccinating people against the coronavirus.
Le module de retour de la sonde spatiale chinoise atterrit durant la nuit dans la région de Mongolie intérieure.
Well, it's official. The UK is out of the EU customs union and single market. And all eyes are now on the new customs border.
Welcome to all of you. It's now time to turn towards 2021. I'll be doing some a few moments with Olivier. Before starting, let me just point out that you can put your questions at any time in the chat to the right of your screen. The answers will be given as we go along with the members of the team. Without further ado, let's start with our investment strategy for 2021. What a year! Yes, a year where the final finish didn't reflect the volatility we saw throughout this long year. If you look at the scores, we can see that tech equity, almost 50% rise on Nasdaq, reflected in the performance of Chinese stock markets and in the performance of S&P 500. And you know that the GAFAs are the main components of that. Whereas Europe is lagging behind once again with slower growth, less tech, but corrected for the foreign exchange effect, we have a slightly positive performance. And also defensive assets that played their role as a buffer assets with a good performance of the U.S. 10-year rates and European state borrowings and even gold. In this abundant universe, it offered the protection. 2020, we saw the worst stock market crisis in history? No, it wasn't. The length and depth of the decline had never been seen before, losing almost 35% on S&P in just a few weeks' time. And it's true that this is the first time in history we have ever seen more significant declines. What was exceptional was the extent of the rebound. In the second quarter of 2020, S&P 500, in just 3.5 months, returned to its initial levels. Even more recently, in November, we saw a rebound in European stock markets in Italy and Spain, achieving the best month in history, and even the S&P 500 achieving its best November since 1928. About central banks, the reaction of central banks was the same as in 2008. Well, the central banks, yes, they were very swift. They injected liquidity abundantly, but what was special about 2020 as compared to 2008 was the concomitance of the fiscal stimulus, the budgetary expenses to maintain business with a lot of liquidity. What makes the crisis in 2008 or 2011 different when you saw this the peripheral sovereign crisis in Europe, the concomitance of these two levers. So central banks on the one hand, states on the other, with a fiscal stimulus that had never been seen before. The debt level, wouldn't you say it's too high today? And how can we move away out of this situation? When you look at the debt level in developed countries in about 15 years' time, overall, we went from 60% of debt over GDP to almost 120% of debt over GDP. What's very special in this boom in the amount of debt is the fact that debt interest, servicing the debt, that didn't soar. For France, for example, in 2021, the French state will be paying less debt interest, about 27, 28 billion U.S. versus 32, 33 this year. The decline in interest rates or negative rates enabled us to have this odd situation where the debt stock is increasing, but the interest is declining every year. And what's the way out then? The way out, either, well, perpetualization maybe. So we'll continue with the debt and with the previous debt before COVID. Are there any other risks to be watched for 2021? There are always risks. One of the first risks this year is the health response if it's not as fast as what the market expects. That's the first risk. The second risk may be new tensions between China and the U.S. from a commercial standpoint. It can also be with overheating in credit markets in China. You know that China is one of the countries with the highest private debt over GDP ratios. It's the opposite of developed countries. So you may have a credit crisis that is still possible. In Europe, the insufficient calibration of fiscal stimulus could be worrying. Or let's say a certain slowness in implementing programs that were accepted. Another risk that you can have is the decline in foreign exchange with the decline of the dollar and the American elections with new political or legal issues with the GAFAs. But the most important risk in 2021 could be the emergence of inflationist tensions on the American market. Because here, all the performance we've seen in recent years was based on the decline in interest rates. The U.S. 10-year rates, which would be closer to 5 years, that could be worrying. Maybe we could now talk about 2021, even though we started talking about it. But the first question, according to the LFDE, is there still any potential on equity after this performance that you spoke of? Well, if you believe, as we do, in a cyclic rebound thanks to monetary and fiscal support that I spoke of earlier, we may consider that an acceleration in the profits of companies is possible. 2020, we saw a recession in profits and in valuation multiples. In 2021, we can have a rebound of profits that can enable less multiples for valuations and the progress in stock market equity. If you look at the market, risk premium is slightly above historical highs thanks to a very low interest rates that we're living in. It doesn't seem unreasonable. We spoke a lot this year about growth and value and a choice between both, is that an issue in 2021? What's true is that value, per se, has underperformed significantly for years now. In 2020, the difference between MSCI growth and value is about 40% underperformance for value. We believe that there are three market segments to be looked at. First of all, growth values. They won't disappear in 2021. Changes in behavior, accelerations in digitization, working from home. These are all reasons why it will continue to thrive. But let's be reasonable. When it comes to valuations, you can't put everything in the same bag. Instead of value, I would speak about cyclical. If, like us, you're thinking of cyclical thanks to the fiscal stimulus I spoke of earlier, we're talking about quality cyclical equity that should have a good year in 2021. That's true for growth cyclical and for value cyclical. The third category where we recommend you should avoid our value traps. Companies that are in sectors that were totally disrupted by the recession in 2020, and it will be difficult for them to recover. Not because they're inexpensive, that they will come back in 2021. So watch out for value traps, but quality cyclical assets could be good for 2021. Another phenomenon that was noteworthy in will be noteworthy in 2021, thematic equity. Would you say that this thematic momentum will continue in 2021? We have identified two types of thematic equity that will be covered in the next two workshops. First of all, ESG, responsible investments. The flows and inflows in funds positioned in these themes are rising sharply, and anyway, investors will be more and more demanding when it comes to the assets in which funds invest. So ESG, SRI, these are basic themes where we are well positioned and we shall continue to thrive in 2021. Now, secondly, in our workshop today, thematic funds are a bit more special. You have basic themes that will not disappear next year. It may be health, digital, or robotics. These are themes where the future seems to be bright for values, assets that are well positioned. But once again, you must be selective. You must offer quality assets in this segment. And the mere fact of belonging to theme of the future doesn't justify excessive valuations. You note that in 2020, we had a distribution of performance based on geographies that were quite different. Now, will we experience the same phenomenon in 2021? There are some geographic areas that are more interesting for you to focus on? Well, to begin with, if you're looking for cyclical assets linked to a rebound of growth, Europe is a good area for value. As you know, we have a lot of discounted industrial equity linked to quality cyclical equity that are directly linked to the economic activity. So Europe is a good hunting ground in 2021 as a growth driver. When you look at the growth of economic zones, you know that Asia will account for more than one-third of global GDP at the end of the decade. So this is an area that you must look at. There are two ways of doing so, by buying directly Asian stocks, Chinese stocks, for example, or by investing in European or American stocks that are exposed to these geographic zones. It's the best of both worlds. You have the protection of accounting rules and political rules that are quite stable, and an exposure to these geographic areas. So the presentation wouldn't be complete if I didn't speak about credit. That's its initial speciality, even though you have evolved since. What about credit? Is that an opportunity for this year? Well, credit spread are very much compressed and manipulated. The interest rates are manipulated by central banks, and the credit spreads are also manipulated. For example, you saw that in 2020, for the very first time, the Fed bought high yields, corporate securities, so credit in 2021, there'll be no big accidents. The prices are manipulated, but it won't be a source of performance. It will be a source, let's say, of controlling portfolio volatility. There will be accesses. Well, credit, I would say, in 2021 will play its role as a buffer value while waiting for better times to come. It's now time to move on to assertions. This is a classic at LFDE in these major meetings year after year. We've always ended with a range of assertions. So I will let you now describe or give us your assertions. Well, five major assertions for 2021. First of all, with vaccination policy and monetary and budgetary fiscal support, 2021 looks favorable for risky assets. In other words, you're reasonably optimistic for risky assets in 2021. That's my first point. Secondly, as I said earlier, quality will pay, be it for value or for growth. We must continue to be very selective. And 2019 was an index-based asset. 2020 was sectorial. 2021 will be a year of high selectivity and discrimination. To play around on this conviction, you can use global funds like the World Equity Growth or even our European mid-caps fund. The third conviction, as I said before, that you must be exposed to the Asia. You can do so at LFDE through thematic funds that contain a lot of Asian stocks and in a way that are invested in trends that are buoyant in these geographic areas. The fourth conviction, and we spoke about this earlier, is that, well, credit has a low appeal, but a limited risk. So it may be an interesting asset if ever spreads were to move away during a period of anguish that the market always looks at some time during the year. Maybe you can find a better entry point than at the start of the year. But when it comes to controlling volatility, it could be an interesting asset for 2021. And the fifth point relates to ESG, responsible investments. It's no longer enough to have labels. We have labels, a lot of them, but it's no longer enough to have an integration of ESG in your entire range as we do. You must move towards impact, and we're doing so. We have a first positive impact fund in our range. We just launched a second one on the climate, and it's a strong conviction for LFDE that impact is the future of investments. Thank you, Olivier, for all these explanations on our macroeconomic scenario for this year, 2021, and it's now time, and I think it was a fine transition with your last point, to start a roundtable on responsible investments and investments in impact. So, hello, Adrien. Hello, Pierre. Welcome to this panel discussion on responsible investments and the Impact Fund. You are the manager in charge of managing large caps for growth at LFDE. So, positive impact and funds. Hello, Pierre. You just joined LFDE during the midst of the lockdown, the 1st of December, to strengthen our SRI and impact teams with a long experience, but we'll come back to that. Maybe I'll start with a brief introduction to remind you of several things. Responsible investment, that's not new at LFDE. Since 1991, we're the foundation of LFDE, and we've been very attentive to governance. In a way, we have been responsible investors since then. In 2007, we developed a proprietary methodology on ESG. All of our range today is ESG, as a matter of fact. Amongst other things, and I like this because it's indistinctive, in our world, you don't have that many who have signed the principles, UN principles for responsible investments in 2008. We started our first SRI labeled funds in 2011. and a major NFTE, and our know-how is the best proof of this. I could mention 9 SRI-labeled funds and 50% of outstanding amounts at the end of 2020 a few days ago, and the range of responsible funds that will be increased by impact funds that already include an impact fund. A first question after this lengthy introduction, maybe, Adrien, for you, how would you say that NFTE is legitimate for SRI? That's a good question. Our legitimacy at LFDE dates back from the foundation of our establishment, as you said before. It started with sectoral exclusions. We started by excluding tobacco, weapons, and other exclusions afterwards. In fact, we are pioneers. At the start of 2007, we formalized an SRI approach that is, I believe, one of the most complete and certainly considered as one of the most well thought out on the Paris market. And clearly, it has left a mark on recent years. For 14 years now, we have been doing SRI at LFDE, and we have a deep knowledge of companies. We have an extraordinary database, which is a gold mine of information and data for management teams today. So yes, clearly, LFDE is fully legitimate when it comes to SRI. Now, you just joined us. I'm sorry to stress this point, but maybe you could express your feelings. From what you have seen, how would you say that the SRI approach at LFDE stands out from the others? What surprised me and that I found remarkable is that this approach, well, the SRI analysis at LFDE is done in-house entirely, involving the entire management teams. I think it's surprising for a company, a management company, to find that. Another strong point for me is that it gives a prevailing role to governance, and meeting with companies' management is something we do systematically, which is a strength that lets us stand apart, because SRI cannot be relevant if it's only based on what companies publish in the CSR report or in extra financial ratings, because that leads to a communication bias for the benefit of large caps, which have a lot of tools to communicate on CSR. And they have a lot of means with dedicated teams, and it favors large caps versus small caps without a dedicated team or without the necessary means and tools to communicate, even though they often have very good ESG practices in some cases. So meeting with company management is the right way to properly assess companies' ESG strategy. It's also a tool that will help to establish dialogue with companies, to speak about the strengths and weaknesses of companies when it comes to ESG, and to urge them to improve their practices. And that is the goal of an ESG analysis, integrating ESG criteria to improve the companies where we plan to invest. Adrien, a question we often hear about SRI, that is bad for performance. The answer is no. About 2 years ago, we published a detailed report on a correlation between the good SRI policies and stock market performance. The result was clear. SRI is not bad for performance. And when you look at the major sustainable funds, in 2019, their performance was quite, was a record, really. When you look at the major SRI funds in 2019 at LFDE, they were able to exceed their historical performance. And in 2020, these large funds re-edited that achievement. They did it again. How do you explain that overperformance? The interesting thing is that the good cases of ESG amongst the companies have a growth biases. Now, these historical biases helped the large funds to withstand market shocks, as was the case in 2020. The interesting thing is that when things picked up again in March, April, well, let's say in April of this year, they took the rise on board. So SRI limits the shock downwards, which is good. When you look at companies like Infineon or Neon, which have a good ESG profile, these are companies that have largely doubled in 2020. In the introduction, I spoke about the impact funds. Adria, why develop impact funds alongside this range of socially responsible investments? Well, we believe in impact funds. We launched our second one this year. It's the new frontier for responsible investments. The goal is, well, basically, to create a positive impact on people and on the planet, and above all, to be able, well, the important thing is to be able to measure that positive impact and to be able to demonstrate it with the fund. In the final analysis, we believe that impact is important to prepare for the world of tomorrow and to finance sustainable development goals. So impact is key for responsible investments. Paul, what distinguishes a socially responsible investment approach, SRI, from an impact approach? In an SRI approach, we integrate environmental, ethical, and social criteria in addition to financial criteria. We identify the companies with the best ESG practices to exclude those with poor ESG practices, because we consider that an SRI analysis allows us to identify reputational and other risks that are not taken into account in a conventional analysis. In impact, we have a real clear objective, as Adrien said, of generating a positive impact, be it on society, on the environment, through investments. And above all, we must be able to assess that impact. So there's a real goal. It's an investment. We must achieve a financial performance, but also a dual objective with an extra financial performance that must be positive. At LFDE today, our impact approach, there are two approaches with the climate solution. What they share in common is that they exclude more than other funds, SRI funds. We exclude alcohol, GMOs, or controversial medical practices. To be eligible for the fund, the companies must have a minimum ESG score. Plus, we have a proprietary scoring linked to impact. For Echiquier Positive Impact, we measure to what extent companies provide solutions or have initiatives favoring the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, seeking to improve health, education, gender equality, and also the climate. We also have a score for climate, and climate maturity, measuring to what extent companies have made progress in the fight against global warming. Concretely, to be picked in our climate fund, companies, well, we carry a financial and an SRI analysis and an impact analysis that's specific to the two impact funds. As a partner, for you, what's the added value of the solution climate or Echiquier Positive Impact for clients? How should that present it? Impact gives meaning to investment, so it has two goals, the financial performance and an extra financial performance. In solutions climate, for example, it offers our investors a solution to finance the energy transition and helping them to contribute through the investments, because it's not just companies who must take part in the fight against global warming. Our clients through the investment choices, can take part in the fight against global warming as well. For our climate solution, this is the fruit of 18 months of work at LFDE. So we set up an approach that seeks to be original and pragmatic, since we want a fund that is representative of the real economy. So all sectors have a role to play in the fight against global warming. So we propose a diversified fund in terms of sectors, where some competitors will be restricted to companies in sectors that promote the energy transition. We want a more diversified fund, considering that each sector has a role to play. In our investment process, we'll have three segments. Of course, we'll find companies bringing solutions to the offer of products and services to fight against global warming, renewable energy, players in the sustainable transportation, for example, or helping to modernize energy in buildings. So that's a solutions segment that's significant in the fund. We also have a pioneer segment, selecting companies that are pioneers in the fight against global warming, even though they don't offer concrete products and services. We choose those that are the most mature, with significant goals with respect to their sectorial benchmarks, with respect to reducing CO2 emissions, which will help to promote the energy transition in these sectors and also with their suppliers. A third segment is the transition segment, where we have opted for something that's important in our investment process. We didn't exclude fossil energy because for us it's a high carbon sector. So you want to support that sector to move towards an energy transition and a low carbon model, so we can pick and help companies that are the most virtuous when it comes to transitions towards that sector. A solution, I believe, that could cater to requests made by clients who'd like to invest their money while paying attention to the impact on the climate and global warming, and so on. One thing I'd like to add, in our climate approach, we also have an important point. We want to focus on commitment. For us, helping companies, as I said before, in the fight against global warming is very important. We'll therefore set up an annual seminar to see to it that all the stakeholders in our fund meet each year and the companies that we select, so that they can share the best practices together, things that will be virtuous in the fight against global warming. Just one question, maybe, that comes to mind, Adrien. Did we inject more means, given these new initiatives, amongst the management teams at LFDE? Clearly, we invested a lot of means, recruiting 5 people. In the management team, we recruited 2 people, including a manager, plus a dedicated analyst on SRI funds. We recruited 3 people on the SRI Research Fund. But the most important thing is that management at LFDE, 35 people, all of the management is based on SRI, and that is key. That's a difference that we find with LFDE. It's now time to conclude. I'd like to thank both of you. I think we fully understand that SRI is a powerful tool, and the best testimonial to that is when you look at these statistics. 75% of our range has a score of 4 or 5 stars at Morningstar. An important commitment at LFDE, 9 labeled fund, SRI labeled fund, 50% of assets under management, 6 billion in assets under management, and you could stress the impact of this new initiative. With Echiquier, positive impact is not quite new, but it helps to find a solution to the specific aspirations of customers, enabling you to meet requests made by your investors. Thanks to all of you.
Bonjour à tous les deux.
Hello to both of you for this panel discussion on thematic funds and strategies. Stephanie, hello. Hello, Pierre. You are in charge, I believe you're very well known, actually, of managing small and mid-caps at LFDE. But here you're here to represent European management. Hello, Rolando, we all know you. Hello, Jean. Hello, Pierre. You're in charge of thematic management and global management at World Equity. Orlando, a question. LFDE, how did we come about creating a thematic or multi-thematic management? Well, first of all, in 2010, about 10 years ago, we decided to capitalize on our know-how in stock picking and convictions to historically deploy the European equity here on a global turf. In 2010, the World Equity Growth enabled us to prove our worth in global equity. For more than 10 years, the fund has been delivering very good performance, always ranked amongst the top in the category. And in 2013, we launched World Next Leaders Global Equity, positioned on mid-caps and multi-theme above all, invested on trends that are shaping our future. It is this experience on themes that enabled us to launch themes dedicated to solutions like intelligence, artificial intelligence in 2018 or health in 2019. Now, this is on the side, but we'll talk a bit about thematic management and the excellent performance in 2020. Could you tell us, give us two or three explanations to justify your performance? How did you manage to generate that performance with your teams? Thank you so much for having noted that we're ending 2020. That was unprecedented at every level. Our thematic funds was able to deliver a performance that was quite robust and resilient despite a complicated context. There are several reasons for that. Let me recall that 2020 saw the emergence of the biggest health crisis in history, in modern history anyway, with a health crisis that became an economic crisis, calling for a general lockdown of the populations to curb the spread of this problem. So that deeply changed the way households and people and companies and governments acted, consumed, invested, and interacted, creating an acceleration of several trends. Take households, for example, with e-commerce that was massively adopted to be able to buy at home, telemedicine for remote medicine, or online streaming of video games. The same for companies with a massive adoption of working from home, the cloud, cybersecurity, and for governments, the same thing, a massive adoption of digitization in their operations. All of our thematic funds were positioned on these future themes, so it benefited from an exponential growth in the demand for these products and services that led to a stock market performance for our funds. Stephanie, for Europe, have you noted an impact of the different themes that he spoke of? Yes. The EU has never been seen such a dominance of these themes. Given uncertainties, investors favored structural performance that would be unrelated to the business environment. Look at 2020. You have digitization, staying at home, health in general, that performed by more than 30% in 2020, despite the what we saw at the end of the year with the emergence of new themes, with the announcement of the arrival of vaccinations, with the end of the lockdown, talking about a V-shaped recovery of the economy. Olivier spoke about this too, but this was a buoyant theme that grew by 30% since the start of the year, driven by the blue wave in the US and by billions of euros invested in ESG funds. So lots of themes that were working in 2020. And the health crisis was global. We find these themes on many markets in Europe and around the world. The differences, though, in the performance spread were there. Why? Because the success of a theme depends on the depth of an investment universe on that theme. Clearly, American markets progressed by 16% for S&P, over 40% for Nasdaq, at the same time minus 3% for European markets. The main reason was the difference in weighting of tech stocks on the American market, accounting for over 50% of S&P, we have less instruments in Europe when it comes to digitization. That's less the case on small caps, and that's certainly why the overperformance of small caps in Europe in 2020. Another question on thematic management. Once again, there are many questions put to us. This performance, can it be replicated, Rolando? I wouldn't speak about replicate, because we don't know. There's no crystal ball in our business, but I could answer with conviction that I believe that we can have a sustainability of our performance for two reasons. First of all, the trends I mentioned earlier are trends that are only starting. E-commerce, despite an increase multiplied by two, and its penetration is only one-fifth of the penetration. We still have 80% that the leading companies in e-commerce can look for. As for the cloud and digital transformation, we're talking about the 21st century factory, we're only talking about the 30% penetration. So these themes, this deep trend, help us to move forward. And secondly, by stock picking, a conviction where, as asset managers, we must arbitrate on our portfolios so as to focus on the best ideas, fundamental themes, and policies and valuation. Valuation, what should I answer to a partner who says that valuation is too high for the themes today? Well, I think you must always keep an eye on valuation. A company, even if it looks great, bought at a high price is not a good investment. In 2020, valuation levels and multiples and sales revenue increased. There are several factors, and I'll come back to that. You also have the context. The interest rates declined, and the monetary policies of the central banks were accommodating, as Olivier said earlier in his presentation. This is a mechanical impact. At the same time, there's a parallel with the real estate investment. In real investment, we have the location, which is greater than the rest. But there's a premium on the rest of the market. It's surprising when you have to pay a discount. The same thing for our companies, which are growth companies with a strong leadership in their sector, an ability to innovate that's quite interesting, with huge markets they can address. And since we're keeping an eye on governance, that's very important, led by managers who founded these companies who are visionaries, and that justifies a premium on the rest of the market. It's up to us to calculate how consistent it is with intrinsic values of the companies, and it's satisfactory for the time being. Stephanie, first specialist in European equity, valuation on that sector. Now, would you say that it's aligned on what you can see globally and more so in the U.S.? Not yet, I would say, especially when it comes to tech stocks, where American companies are reaching multiples we haven't seen yet in Europe, apart from a few exceptions. What's clear for everyone is that growth values have changed significantly over the past 3 or 4 years, and that's partly due to the rotation we saw at the end of 2020, start of 2021, justifying a certain caution in the way we deal with the markets in 2021. What's clear today is that we have a strong conviction on these long-term values, and they'll continue to do well for two reasons. First of all, this is a market where interest rates will remain low over the long term, and the market is such that global growth is weak. And the second reason, and it's a deep conviction, is that the main performance drive on the stock market remains profitable growth. 2021, Olivier said this, will have less of an impact on rating, but will still have a powerful driver with profit growth. We saw the performance of European management, which is extremely good, in 2020. Growth funds of high quality, you mentioned that, benefiting from the good momentum of themes, even though it's complicated to see the exact mirror effect. But could you speak about how the European management team, that is, pick these themes. We're looking for a theme. It's all about properly understanding the underlying market and its growth drivers. It may be demographics, digitization, globalization. There are many structural growth drivers. There's nothing revolutionary, but you must be aware of the fact that there's some themes that are unrelated to the business environment and that are more buoyant than others. So we practice, we have been practicing this for years at LFDE, and we're very close, in fact, to the multi-thematic approach. When you look at our European equity management, we can say that's all about stock picking. That helps us to be exposed to growth themes over the long term and that are buoyant in the small cap, mid cap, large cap portfolio, convertibles, international. We find some themes, for example, the digital disruption with ASOS, Ocado, HelloFresh, or the example of e-payments with securities in large caps like Worldpay. In small caps, it was more Nets in Nordic countries or Worldline in France. We can give the example of the population with investment in aging populations with Orpia, Korean and convertible funds. The many themes. The most important one is probably sustainable development. So we have ESG funds, and we also have the renewables and sustainable development as a theme that was very impactful for the fund's performance in 2020, with securities like Neon, Albiona, Orsted, amongst large caps. So this theme was important. Next, our approach as a stock picker, how do we stand out, or how do we differentiate from a thematic approach? Because we do stock picking that's positioned for growth, instead of looking for a specific theme. Then you can have cross-fertilization. In other words, we're pulling on a thread. In small caps, we've invested in a German company making software for hospitals called Nexus, a German company, and that we identified for its growth factors. And then we realized that was a very appealing sector, and that led us to look for securities like Cramware in the UK, CSAM Health in Nordic countries, or CompuGroup in Germany. Now, Rolando, this thematic management and European management, how do they coexist at the teams in LFDE? First of all, we do data processing in our business. The important thing is to be able to exchange, communicate, and create value on all the data we look for in our work as analysts and in management. We must bring a global viewpoint on the different innovations we find in the US, the Silicon Valley, in Asia, in China, the capital of artificial intelligence, or Latin America. We see the birth of fintechs that are quite interesting. So we work constantly to identify trends, as Stephanie said, that are very much global, and that you find in Europe and elsewhere, to have exchanges and to invest concretely together, like Ocado in the UK, or in Voltania, in a French company in renewable energy. Stephanie? Yes, team management is really key at LFDE. We even talk about co-management. We have a lot of exchanges between teams and within the teams. We worked a lot with Rolando's teams on some themes. It may be on a security. He spoke about Ocado, our small cap team invested in it. It's under 2 billion. And at one point, with the securities performance, we took it out of our investment universe. And it was a good instrument for Rolando's funds. We also worked on, together on sectors where the sectoral expertise held by the other teams was important for us. I'm thinking of Blue Prism in the UK on a sector known as RPA, Robotic Process Automation. Rolando knows it well, and we spoke about it together. Another more conventional case was GN Store North, a company producing hearing devices and audio headsets. And audio headsets benefited a lot from working from home. They benefited before the deep penetration of what you call UCaaS software, helping different platforms to communicate together. We spoke a lot with Rolando about the penetration of these type of software. So we spoke about sectors and, more formally speaking, in weekly management meetings we have once per week. And also, a Phoenix database that have existed for 20 years now, where we share our know-how. And you work on the same plateau. So aside from all of these formats, it's easy to have an exchange of views. You spoke about working together. Both of you work on a thematic fund, a health solution. How do you work together on that fund? In actual fact, we realized that health was a very important theme in our funds, European equity or European smaller and mid-caps or global funds. The second thing we realized is that the investment universe on this theme was quite deep, enough for us to build a thematic fund. Furthermore, within this health theme, you had sub-themes that were quite varied, with correlations that were also varied and interesting to set up a fund. You can invest in the health sector, in diagnosis, in biotech, in digitizing hospitals, for example, in population, aging populations, many interesting sub-themes. So the fund today is formed of three segments. We have one large-cap European equity, one global equity, and another segment for small-cap European equity. So three themes, three investment universes, three types of expertise to benefit the most from a sectoral theme that we find very attractive. So three management teams and a global expertise. Would you like to add anything to that? Quite simply, to add to what Stephanie said, we're very enthusiastic about growth potential in health. 2020 taught us a lot because of the crisis we experienced. And there's one thing we learned, the importance of technological and scientific innovation. That's what we find in health, a theme that is buoyant with innovation that makes me very enthusiastic. For example, DNA sequencing, genetics, telemedicine, or nanobots, many investment opportunities that are quite varied and diversified with expertise at LFDE working together on these interesting and original funds. I'm so sorry, but we are now come the end of the time allotted, so I must thank you for all of your interesting explanation. Maybe you'd like to stress one point. Well, thematic management is important at LFDE because we have six thematic funds representing 2 billion euros in assets under management. And above all, it's powerful. We saw with the wonderful performance of your SRI funds, and 6-7% of our fund rated 4 or 5 stars. That brings us to the end of our investment strategy for 2021. The teams are here to answer all the questions that were put on the chat. I'd like to thank all of you for being so many today, and see you soon.